which one here? This is.
With everything inside it, to have connection between the different teams and the facility of functional for the production of the wine, because he wanted to work more precisely, to use more technology, and also to work in a more gentle way for the wine, with a gravity system. And so now we only use the gravity for the transfer of the wine. We don't use any pumping machines, because pumping the wine, and we have to transfer it from the fermentation tanks to the barrels, for example, it's a bit aggressive. It always shakes a little bit the wine. It can bring some oxygen. With oxygen, we can also have oxidation. To avoid this, we only work with gravity thanks to three levels now. The first floor, to be able to fill from the top 80 stainless steel tanks that are on the ground for the fermentations, and then completely underground the barrel cellar for the aging into your barrels. To build such a building, the family worked with two architects. First, a friend of them, the American architect Didi Pei, the son of Ian Pei, who built in France the Pyramid du Louvre in Paris. So this is why we have the same style here, the style of the Pei family. Glass, steel, concrete, very modern materials. And we also worked with a French architect, Arnaud Bounon, specialized into the technical part for the production of the wine. Important to have a beautiful building, but very important to be able to produce some wine inside this beautiful building. And before to build it, the family and the two architects had first about 10 years of reflection to think about the quality, about the equipment, before to start the renovation in 2017. It ended in 21, but of course during the 4 years we had to produce some wine, and for it we had to bring the old stainless steel tanks that we had before into another technical building, close to this one. You can see it a little bit from here. It's the big white building on the other side of the world, behind the houses. And it's where we produced the vintages 2017, 2018, and 2019. But for 2020, we were very lucky, because the technical part here was done just before the harvest. It was the first vintage produced in the new facility. So in the offices, at least part of the entrance, that was done in 21. And then, with the pandemic, we had to wait a little bit before to welcome the visitors again. So this is why we opened this year, the the 21st of March, the day of spring, and the opening. And it's these new facilities that you're going to see this afternoon. And I have to warn you, it's very modern. We'll think that we're in a spaceship. A lot of tanks, 80 stainless steel tanks, very modern. 80 tanks, it's a lot. It's because in the vineyard, we also have 80 blocks of vines. 110 hectares for the vineyard, one of the biggest vineyards of the appellation. We can produce 52 red wines. Two-thirds of the production is the great white Château Lynch-Bages, made with the oldest plots of vines. And one-third is the second wine called Echo de Lynch-Bages, ECHO, made with the youngest vines. And to produce these blended wines, we use 4 grapes, 75% of Cabernet Sauvignon, 18% of Merlot, 5% of Cabernet Franc, and 2% of Petit Verdot. And as we have 110 hectares and 4 grapes, the vineyard is divided in 80 plots of vines, and this is why we have one tank per plot in order to keep all the characteristics of each plot and of each grape separately during the fermentations. And so, as I told you, we started the fermentations. It's because we finished Saturday the harvest. Usually the harvest here lasts about 2 weeks. And see, we are about 50 people working all year long at Lynch-Bages. During harvest time, we can have 180 people more, seasonal workers, to be able to harvest everything by hand and to have the first hand sorting directly into the vines before to bring the grapes into the reception of harvest to do the distilling, for example, the sorting and the crushing. So to talk more about the production of this wine, I suggest you to go into the technical part. So to follow them. Huge, very modern. They from 75 to 185 hectoliters. It was very important that the tanks had the same size than their own plot.
75 hectoliters. 7,500 liters.
Yeah.
Wow.
So I told you about harvest time, harvest by hand. Then the grapes arrive at the reception of harvest. But my colleagues are finishing to clean and to take off the equipment too. It's in the reception of harvest where we receive the grapes that we have to destem these grapes. We always separate the stems from the fruits at the beginning to take the bitterness away. Then we have 2 lines of hand sorting, which is the best there is, and 1 line of optical sorting with a machine. Then we have to crush these fruits very gently, just to open a little bit the skin to release the juice and the sugar. And then we have these vallions that we have to fill with the crushed fruits in the reception of harvest. And from here, we can see that we have some mechanical lines on the top, on the front floor. So they're going to carry these vallions to lift them up and to bring them on the first floor on this side. And once that the vallions are on the first floor, we just have to mount them on the top of the fermentation tanks to feed them with gravity with the crushed fruits. And once that the tanks are full, we can start the vinification with first alcoholic fermentation that we still have during these tanks. So the yeast and the sugar are working together to create alcohol. But during this fermentation, we also always have some heat, and it's important to control it. So we have a double wall system inside all these tanks. So inside this double wall system, we have warm or cold water that circulates in order to warm the tanks up or to cool them down, to always have between 28 to 30 degrees Celsius. And during this fermentation, we also have some carbon dioxide, some gas that always brings all the skins on the top of the tanks. But aromas, tannins, and color, everything that we need for the wine, always under the skins. So to get all this part, to extract this part, we have to do some remontage. We can walk a little bit this way to see how we pass it through the remontage. There are mechanical and hard ground. On this end, we have a technical lab, so they have a general computer. They can program remotely the activity inside the tanks. And you can see that top of the tank thanks to the double mud system. And so, what is going on that we have to add some nitrogen into the wine to push it and to bring it back on the top of the tank, and so the juice will wash out the skins and then extract tannins, cut off the aromas. So this one has on mechanical. We like technology at Lynch-Bages, as you can see. We have this advantage during the alcoholic fermentation, but then we have to follow the other steps of vinification with the maceration. Very important to have more aromas with the skins that stay in contact with the juice. Then we have the écoulage. We have to take what we call the free run wine, the juice, and then we have to get the skins in order to press them. This time it's the pressurage to get the pressed wine, more concentrated with more tannins and more color thanks to the skins. And we always add some pressed wine into the free run wine, but the percentage of it depends on the vintage, the natural concentration of the free run wine. And then we have the last fermentation, the malolactic fermentation with the lactic bacteria that will transform the malic acid that we have also into green apples into lactic acid, much sweeter like in yogurt or milk. And it's a natural way to reduce the acidity into the wine. And after this fermentation, we are done with the vinification process, usually after about 3 months. So we have to do the blending and the transfer of the wine. For this, we use 6 lift tanks, elevator tanks. That we are going to see, as I just in the middle of this building. Elevated tanks. We are not the first to have some of these in this area. The first were Cos des Tournelles in Saint-Estèphe and Château Tedesco in Pauillac. They have 4 elevated tanks. Now we have 6 because we need the 6. Not to have 6 of them. As you can see, they are moving between the tank room and the barrel cellar. So this is why we can do the blending inside. So we just have to lift them up at the level just under the fermentation tanks. So we can connect a pipe to fill the lift tanks with gravity. The wine just flows with gravity from the fermentation tanks into the lift, exactly. Once that we have the blending inside, we just have to bring them down to the level just above the barrels. We connect again a pipe. We can fill the barrels with gravity. And so no pumping machines for this transfer of wine. Only a very gentle way of working. Much better for the wine. And if we have to bring the wine back on the top, we just have to reuse these lifts. See, my colleagues are using some of this. It's too early to do the blending. It's because we started the alcoholic fermentation. I told you about the remontage to extract more tannins and aromas in a cycle inside the tank. Right now, my colleagues are doing some délestage. It's like the remontage, but it's more powerful. For this, like what they did, they have to empty completely one of the fermentation tanks to make all the wine into a lift, and then everyone on the first floor, they have to lift this elevated tank on the top so they can connect the pipe again to refill the same tank with its wine, and then with the pressure of all the wine, we will extract more tannins, more color and aromas. The technical advantage, but really more powerful. And for this, we just have to use the elevator tanks.
Remontage is not with gravity, right?
It's a little bit with gravity. We have to bring the wine back on the top, but by pushing it on the top. And then we can also play with the pressure, the liquid pressure inside the tank to maintain the
tank. So you have no pumps involved?
No pumps. Thank you.
It's just so much.
Thank you, thanks. I think your driver told us that you were at, because there's too many before. So maybe you're already familiar with the lift tanks.
It might ruin the wine.
Can I take
the
notice?
Like
a
little young wine.
Oh, so that's coming from
the alcoholic fermentation, and then they will do the maceration.
Okay, there we go.
You can see some QR codes on the tanks. It's because during harvest time, as we have to keep everything separate, we have 80 plots of vines in the vineyard, 110 pictures, and we have 80 stainless steel tanks, one tank per plot, to keep everything separate. During harvest time, we have the QR code system because we have some wagons that we have to lift up from the reception of harvest thanks to the telephone lines here. And to be sure that we have the right wagon on the top of the right tank, we have a fall on the wagon so we can scan this spot to be sure that we are not going doing any mistakes, and also to register everything for the wine master and register everything in the general computer. So keep all the information that we need for the big page. And so, yes, this is the place where the vinification happens. With a lift, tracker system, mechanical lines, a lot of stainless steel, very modern material, very modern equipment, but with what we can call the traditional gravity system, as it was invented in this region in the middle of the 19th century. Here, thanks to the engineer Pierre Skalinski, he went to this area. He visited some wine estates and he saw the workers at a time working with wooden tanks and only scales on it. So they always had to go up and down and up again and down again with equipment on their back. And this engineer just had the idea to add a press from the top of the tanks to keep the equipment on it and to work with gravity. And after this discovery, a lot of wine estates wanted their own Skalinski tank at a time. At Lynch-Bages, we also mounted our own Skalinski tank pool, and we still have it. We don't use it anymore, but it was the inspiration for the new facilities. The family, the Kass family, the owners just wanted to go back to the traditional way of working with gravity. And this is why I suggest you now to have a look at this old Skalinski tank pool and to go back to the 19th century.
Yeah.
Here we go. Is she testing?
She's doing it. She's taking samples because then they must be going to mix before. Before they go into the river, they have to see how they test the time.
Looks like another storm swirl.
Look at that.
So she's taking samples of each.
Because we are going here.
So one of the original buildings of this fine estate was originally as we know, but we kept the tradition. We still have to the classic steps of identification. And we came back to the gravity system. And here, a lot of tradition and gravity system. Remember, we have to lift up some wagons to bring them on the first floor at a time. From the red door, they also had the reception of harvest, and the workers also had to lift up huge baskets full of grapes in order to bring the grapes into this table. To do the destemming, they had to roll the grapes by hand to separate the stems from the fruits. The fruits fell into this crusher. Then it was the tradition, the ladies with the feet had to crush the fruits with the
feet. Really?
Then the men had to move this crusher to bring it in front of the white tank. Thanks to the engineer Pierre Skalinski, it was much easier with the rails that we have on this floor and the wheels that we have on the equipment. Used to work in the railway industry. Very clever from here.
You just
poured it. Mm-hmm. It's more comfortable for the workers. A bit faster here for them. And once that the crusher was in front of the lighting, on both sides we have this opening system. They just had to open it to fill the tanks from the top with the fresh fruits and then start the alcoholic fermentation, then the maceration. Then they have to get the free run wine, the juice, then the skins. To get the skins, the workers had to go completely inside the tanks, so very dangerous with the carbon dioxide. And this is why, like for the mines, they had to go there with a candle,
right,
to see if the flame was moving or not. If the flame was there, they had to go out very quickly. If the flame was not moving, they had enough time to work, take the skins out from these tanks, bring them into a press one like this one and to roll it right now into the pressing machine in order to press the skins and get the pressed wine. And then to add this pressed wine into the free run wine like today. And if they needed more pressed wine, more tannins, more color, like today they just had to press several times. But the only problem with this machine, the system, is that after only one press, they only had dried skins, like a big cake of dried skins. So not easy to have more juice from it. And the solution was to cut this cake and to bring some part of dried skins into the cylinder, which is in the middle, left, which was running mechanically. And inside it, we have like some little teeth that were separating at the same time the dried skins. And then with the natural humidity that we have in the air, here we are in the mid-dock, mid-aqua, between the ocean and the river, the skins were able to have more natural water, so a little bit more juice, and the workers just had to take the skins to bring them back into the pressing machine, to press them again, to have more tannins, more flow, and this several times. So not the same technology than today, but already very modern for the 19th century. And see, with the renovation, we can see that we are almost at the same level on the top of the new tanks. And we can see the same way of working on the other side, but in a more precise and more modern way, thanks to technology. They did a very good job to keep this building. See, like for the wine, we need a blend
to
the very modern materials, the glass, and the concrete.
It's like a hammer, no?
We have now to this old
place. We have lots of
old
trees. Yes, we've got that. Just some. You say this record is not being looked for as well.
Thank you. vintage, dried vintage like this year, we had to add yeast. And also when we have a very wet vintage with too much rain before the harvest, we don't have the yeast, the natural yeast anymore. Okay,
yeah.
So we have to add some. And they can't, you know, when it's too hot, they can die also. So they will not work during the fermentation. So I see the bottom of the wooden tanks, with approximately the same shape as the new tanks and a little bit pyramidal. And this is contrast again with modern and old. And it's the best time. We always
I love the smell.
French oak, but also the traditional barrels for the aging with the circle in chestnut. Usually it's more common to have the metallic circle for the transport. This one was used a long time ago during the aging against the insects, little bugs. They wanted to eat some wood in this in the barrel cellar. The chestnut is more tender than the oak. They had to go first inside the circle to eat it, and the workers just had to replace it to have a new natural protection for the barrels. And so now we don't really have this problem with the insects anymore. So we kept it more for the tradition, also because it's very pretty and aesthetic. Mm-hmm. And we don't see it in a lot of wine estates neither. We can see the different coopers, Boutesse, Tonnel, Berger et Fils on the right. Are the different producers of barrels. We work with 8 coopers mostly from this area. It's always interesting to have this difference for the coopers because they don't work the same way, which will add a better complexity into the wine. We also have a different aging depending on the wine. If it's the great fine Château Lynch-Bages, 2/3 of the production, or the second fine Eco de Lynch-Bages, 1/3 of the production. Great wine will spend between 14 to 18 months into new oak barrels, 75% new oak, and so we also have 25% of reused barrels. And the second wine will spend 12 months into only reused barrels. Let's see. The wine is already blended inside the barrels, but we work with different coopers, so we can have different aromas. For the great wine, we have both new oak barrels and reused barrels. So, some difference also with the aromas and the tannins. So, this is why, after the aging into the oak barrels, we have to do what we call the phenol blending, the blend of the same wine, but that comes from the different barrels, from the different coopers, to have homogeneity at the end in order to have the same wine in all the bottles. And so, for this, we have to bring once again a bite into the barrels with like a double entrance to add some nitrogen to push the wine into the pipe and to bring it into the lift tanks that are still in the middle. So we can do the final blending inside these lift tanks. And once that we have this final blending, we have to lift elevator tanks completely on the top, on the first floor. So we can connect a pipe to refill the stainless steel tanks in order to filter the wine before to do the bottling. Important to filter the wine with here the traditional egg white that will coagulate all the little sediments we still have into the wine, to only have liquid to prepare it for the bottling that will be back on the reception of harvest, back at the beginning, upstairs. So this equipment is the best one for the wine, because once that the wine is at the bottom, we can bring it back on the top to reuse the gravity from the beginning to the end. We only have 21 here. We bottled 2020 in June. And here on this side, we have the great wine. So like this, my colleagues know where to go to do some samples on the first or on the second. No mistakes. Of course, everything is also registered.
It's like a for pressing.
Thank you. also going to start with this origins, with the Château and with the base vintage 2016.
What can you say?
This time, we have 69% of Cabernet Sauvignon, 26% of Merlot, 3% of Cabernet Franc, and 2% of Petit Verdot. And we also have 75% of new oak barrels and an aging of 18 months. And now it's more about the fruits and the barrels. They're much from the oak, less spices than with the other beds.
Oh, I also saw this one.
Mm-hmm.